name. Hallelujah. We put away our own agenda and we came to worship you, Jesus. In spirit and truth, God, we're looking for a mighty move today, Jesus. Hallelujah. Move of your spirit, Jesus. Fall fresh on us today, Lord God. Hallelujah. And we'll thank you for it. Hallelujah. In your name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. Oh, we turn to you and hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. Oh God, we long for you, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praise. Hosanna, Hosanna. So come everywhere.
God, you make us new. King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, rise up. Who can stand against us? You are strong to say in your mighty name. King of heaven, come.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. Let's sing it out this morning.
You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers far and deeper still. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. And you are perfect in all of your ways. Oh, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. It's who
you are, Lord. You are welcome here right now. Oh, you are welcome here, Holy One. Oh, you are welcome here. Oh, you are welcome here. You are
let your glory fall on us. That's our prayer, that's our prayer. Oh, let your glory fall.
Fall fresh, Jesus.
Oh, let your glory fall. Oh, let your glory fall. Sing that again, let your glory. Oh, let your glory fall. Oh, let your glory fall. Oh, let your glory fall on us.
One more time, let your glory. Oh,
let your glory fall. Oh, let your glory fall. Oh, let your glory fall on us. The Spirit of God, come like the dawn and open the heaven on us. 'Cause we want to know you. We want to know you. We want to know. Oh, Spirit of God, Spirit of God, come like the dawn. Open the heavens on us. 'Cause we want to know you. We want to know you. We want to know you. Spirit, Spirit of God, come like the dawn and open the heavens on us. We want to know you. We want to know you. We want to know you more. And how is your love marvelous? How
Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. The Bible says his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And you know what? You can add one more word to that paragraph. Marvelous. How marvelous in our eyes is our God this morning. Amen. How many are happy to be in church this morning? Amen. Praise God. Just give the Lord a wave offering this morning. Let him know you're here. Amen. It's good to feel his presence. It's good. God loves when his people worship him. Amen. For being God. Amen. That's the whole thing, isn't it? Praise God. So grateful that he saved us and brought us back to himself. And if you're here this morning and you don't have a relationship with God, you can before you leave this place. Because through his son, Jesus Christ, he has made a way back to himself, back to what he had originally planned for you in the beginning of the world. And that's to be with him forever, and he be your God, and we be his people. Amen? How many are honored to be God's people this morning? Amen. Amen. It's just a great, great privilege, isn't it? Turn to your neighbor and welcome them out this morning. Give them a big smile. If you're visiting, you're our most honored guest this morning. Just enter in to what the Lord is doing. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Before we're seated this morning, let's honor our great country again with our Pledge of Allegiance. Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you so much. God bless you this morning as you're seated. Before we ask for the altar offering helpers to come, I just want to take this time to thank the church this morning. The last few weeks I had been staying home because I had a sudden back problem. Didn't do anything unusual, didn't try to be He-Man and lift something up, you know, heavier than me or something like that. I went to bed one night feeling great, got up the next morning, ouch, just like that. And for a couple of weeks, you know, it just kind of lingered, and we prayed about it and did what we could to help ourselves. However, I had to sit with this thing, you know, this little back thing and all this stuff. But last Sunday morning, how many were here last Sunday morning? Do you remember that mighty move of God that came into this place? Well, I was home watching, and I'll tell you what, the presence of God, I don't know if it can travel through the TV, but that's what it felt like to me. It's like it came out, and then when Pastor got up and said, "Church, there are people home sick, let's pray. You guys prayed for me and for others," and something happened that morning that completely changed it, and I've been 100% ever since. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you for praying, and thank you for coming to church. See, sometimes we forget one of the reasons we gather is not for ourselves all the time, but it's for somebody else who might need. So if you're here and you're hurting this morning, maybe you have a back problem or you have other problems you're facing, don't leave this place without getting prayer at this altar. The body of Christ will pray for you, and something good is going to happen to you in this place today. So I just wanted to share that testimony. Thank you so much. I'm back among the land of the living. Praise God. It's good to see. I was so happy to see our Amen corner over here. Sister Donna and the gang. Amen. It's so great. Sometimes the Lord shows you what you have, what's important. Amen. And I'm glad for that. I'm glad that I can recognize you today. Thank you so much. Well, at this time, we're going to wait in for the offering this morning. Our offering helpers are going to come. Hallelujah. And we have Sister Khadija. All right. Woo-hoo. Brace yourself. No. If you need an envelope, raise your hand. Our offering helpers will see it so you can record your offering. God bless you.
Good morning, church. Good morning. All right. So if you guys need an offering envelope again, you could raise your hand and they'll get it to you. And if you're watching on Facebook and you want to give online, go to the website listed. So in your giving today, I ask that you consider the house of our house of God, like the upcoming oil bill and the maintenance supplies and the monthly upkeep in your giving today. And I was thinking this week about this offering thought, or actually last week, what to bring. Couldn't think of anything. But I started praying. I was like, God, what am I bringing? Sometimes think about a battle, and I was starting to think about war and what it takes to finance a war. And then it got me thinking about how the enemy tries to come against our finances, and spiritually, because we are fighting a spiritual warfare as well. And he does attack the finances and try to cut off our supply sometimes when we want to give. And we are at war. We are at battle at times in different areas in different countries and here at home. And a war is an opened armed conflict between nations or any hostility or struggle. And also, a war sometimes has many little battles, which is a large-scale conflict between armed forces. And it made me think about our military. And with the military, a war takes finances. And there's military logistics. And with military logistics, what it is the discipline of planning and carrying out the movement, supply, and the maintenance of military forces. Also, it helps with design, development, acquisition, storage, distribution, maintenance, evacuation, transport of personnel, acquisition or furnishing of services, medical and health service support. So this morning, when you give, you're not just throwing your money in, but you're fighting today. And your giving is vital to keeping God's kingdom going. And with our giving today, we can combat poverty. My finances are going to push against the gates. It's going to loose the captives. It's going to set at liberty those that are bruised. My giving pleads the cause of the poor. Isaiah says, no weapon, though it may form, no weapon's going to form against thee, but it's going to prosper. We're going to prosper. It's not going to prosper. And also Deuteronomy says, God fights for us. In Deuteronomy 3, ye shall not fear them, for the Lord your God shall fight for you. And I like that every battle God wages, he's going to win. And I thought of a song that says, I'm going to see a victory. I'm going to see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. For God is going to take what the enemy meant for evil, and he's going to turn it for good. God, when you put your offering in today, Say you're going to see a victory. God, whatever's coming against my finances, it shall be no more. It'll stop. God, you're going to bring increase to my life. You're going to bring increase to this church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Dear God, God, we know that in you is the victory, God. And God, you've put this church on a mission. You put this army on a mission, God. The battle is yours. We're going to win, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Increase it. Let it go forth and stop the enemy. Let the poor be uplifted, God. Hallelujah. God, in Jesus' name, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. And I just want to take a little time right now and say thank you, Lord, oh, for all you've done for me. Oh, I just want to take a little time right now and say thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Let's raise our hands and just thank him that you're able to give. Thank him that he's blessed you to give. Thank him for all that he's done for you, all that you possess. Everything that you have in your hands, God gave it to you. So let's just take a moment and just praise him and just thank him for his bounty, for his goodness, for all that we have, for the lunch we're going to have today. For the breakfast tomorrow, and to supply needs of others so they too can have these things. Amen. It's just great to be a Christian, isn't it? Amen. God bless you, and thank you so much for giving this morning. Amen. I know the Lord will bless you abundantly. Amen. Well, if you look around, you'll see some folks missing because our pastor is with all our children over at the Olive Tree having Christmas with them. Amen. So just a reminder to everyone, don't forget your kids. Just don't think you got a day off, you know, after church. Say, hey, man, we're going out to lunch, man. We'll pick them up later. No. No, don't forget to go over to the Olive Tree as soon as church is over and pick up your children. But I'm so glad that their pastor is spending time with them and the leaders of our youth ministry is with them. And that's just a great time, isn't it? And we're here. So turn to your neighbor and say, I'm glad you're here this morning. And Merry Christmas to you in advance. Amen. Christmas to me, if I was president of the United States, and I'm not running for office, but if I was, I would say that Christmas would be an event that would take several days, not just one day. Amen. And Thanksgiving gets 2 days, definitely. Because you have to have the day of Thanksgiving, and then you have to have the next day to have the leftovers. Come on. I mean, this is only fair, okay? Anyways, praise. I'm not running for office, anybody, so don't. I'm not putting my hat in the ring for 2020. I'm not doing that. Although that would be fun to put my name on the ballot, you know? Salvatore Mancini, how do you get over there, you know? I think you got to get like 50,000 signatures, and then you got to get like, I don't know, maybe like $200,000-$300,000. Anybody want to donate? No. You're going to have to forgive me today. I'm very happy, as you can tell, just to be in church. Amen? Amen. Amen. God is good. All right. So don't forget now, next Sunday night, December 15th, is our Christmas Jubilee night. And that is going to be a great time. It's starting at 7 p.m., our regular church service time. And this night will be full of singing, lots of laughs, featuring our music ministry groups such as New Life Choir, Jubilee Tabernacle Choir, which is our younger youth, Pioneers and Mighty Warriors, which is our smallest youth, and much more. So this is going to be a wonderful night of celebrating the birth of Christ. So invite your family and friends and just make a fun night out of it. Come out and let's worship the Lord in remembrance of the greatest event that ever happened to this world, the coming of Christ. Amen? Amen. Praise God. God bless you. And we have Sister Angelina this morning to bring us some great reports.
Amen. Well, I would vote for Reverend Mancini. He got my vote. He's going to win. No. Staying in the Christmas vein, first of all, thank you so much for everyone who has kept Christmas on a mission. Because of you, the financial need has been met. Yay! Thank you, thank you, thank you. So Christmas on the Fields, Christmas in Connecticut, and Black's Christmas are all completely sponsored. So I just wanted to say thank you for helping us meet that need. But if you're still looking to sponsor the Hoving Home Ladies, we do have 15 left. So you can stop in the back and you can see our workers and help us just finalize that. And then Christmas again, staying on a mission, and we'll give a beautiful Christmas to those ladies as well. But we're going to move over into Giving Tuesday. If you guys don't mind getting that ready, I'm going to say a couple things before that starts. The total funds raised as of Friday, December 6th, you ready? Is $3,067. Yes. Oh, that's awesome. We did have a beautiful day together. For those of you that came out, or if you were watching our live feed, we did have a twofold focus for that day, which was raising funds, but then increasing volunteer activity and awareness for all that Worldwide does. And we can say that that day was a success. Even though we had a snow day that gave us a later start, along with it came a bunch of eager youngins ready to work and make a difference. Sorry, does anybody else hear that? You hear that? Okay. Sorry. From sorting donations and packing into boxes and bags, to donation deliveries and pickups, to a run to the Can Redemption Center, delivering all the bags sorted by our church youth, to the special Christmas project for the Zambia School, which was packing the goodie bags, the Blessing Center was a busy hive, buzzing with joy, laughter, Christmas songs, the young mixing with the old, new friendships being made. Our hearts are overwhelmed with the love and the compassion that everyone showed. So if you'll enjoy this little snapshot of the amazing day that we had together.
I think it's just awesome. It's a wonderful feeling here to just be about, I think it's just doing good things and helping others and just being a part of it all. And it's the most worthy thing you can be a part of is helping other lives.
My heart is here because I just love being able to be God's hand extended and Pastor's hand extended.
I personally love the idea of coming here and helping in my free time because it's nice to contribute.
Every time you come here, you have an opportunity to help somebody. Mm-hmm. Like everything that you see around you is going to go to somebody. It's not going to be sold to them. It's going to go to them just simply because they're in need. It's not going to be sold to them. Yes, and that's
those
excellent.
Kids deserve and able to help.
Fantastic. Yes.
It's great to just give somebody hope.
Excellent.
Those children look forward to everything they get. They're appreciative. They have a great joy. And when you go to Zambia and you see those children, many of them don't have hardly anything. But they have such a joy and such appreciation for everything they get. It's just wonderful.
And such appreciation.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. We could not have done any of that without you. However, you can still get in on the volunteering action because even with all that help, we were able to get caught up on a lot of work from so many donations that came in for the months of October and November, but due to the amount of items received, we still need some extra hands. This is a good problem to have. Amen, Sister Donna. This is a good problem to have. So if you have any time to help us, we have to finish up those donations and then wrap up your end inventory before Christmas. That is our goal, and we are going to see it happen. So if you have any extra time over the next couple weeks, stop by Sister Donna. I love it. See our workers in the back, and we'll have a sign up, and just let us know. We have time openings during the day, and then at night, let us know what you can help us do, okay? But thank you, thank you, thank you again to everyone who came out. It was just a beautiful day, absolutely beautiful. So I'm going to move into a good report from Reverend Teachman, who has been in India. Amen. His first report says, here's a praise report from India. We had our first meeting in a home tonight, And a man who had been both drinking and smoking gave his life back to the Lord, and he was fully delivered. Hallelujah, Jesus. His wife and children were praising God as they saw the Lord moving upon his life. A woman who had knee pain, we prayed for her knee, and it was quickly healed. Jesus. The pastor's wife's left eye had been very irritated for a week, but as we prayed, all the irritation left her eye. Praise the Lord. A woman came for prayer. For 2 years, her neck and her shoulders had been in pain. I had all the women gather around her and lay their hands on her shoulders and pray for her. And within seconds, Jesus completely healed her. Hallelujah. Amen. This past Saturday night, we took a two-hour drive to a remote village in South India. In the meeting, I asked the people, who expects to be healed tonight? What a question, huh? I had several of the people testify as to what they expected to be healed from. Three ladies testified that they believed God would do amazing things for them that night. After preaching, I called these three ladies down to the altar to pray for them. The first lady told me she had a lack of blood in her body. She was constantly weak and had pain throughout her whole body. When she walked, she would become exhausted. As we prayed for her, Jesus did the miracle in her blood. She said immediately strength came back into her body. She began to walk for 10 minutes, and when she came back to the church, she said, I feel completely normal. Hallelujah, Jesus. The second woman was the pastor's wife. She had been coughing continually for several months. As we prayed for her, she stopped coughing and told us, I'm completely healed. Hallelujah. The third lady said that she had very severe heart pain. And as we prayed for her, she told me that the pain left her heart. Jesus. A man came down for prayer. He had been in a construction accident and had only partial use of his right hand. He said that the most he could lift was about 5 pounds. Well, after prayer, we had him lift up the pastor's son, who weighs about 40 pounds. He lifted him up so easily and was smiling as Jesus healed his injured hand. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. On Sunday morning, we had a meeting at Pastor Joshua's church. Three Hindu ladies gave their lives to Christ. Two of these ladies were also healed as we prayed for them. Thank you, Jesus. Every other person that we prayed for also told me they received their healing as we prayed in the name of Jesus. People testified that they were healed from back pain, leg pain, full body, and heart pain. God is truly fulfilling his word. As it says in Isaiah 53:5, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Hallelujah. Continue to keep this work in your prayers. God bless you. Can we continue to keep these souls in prayer, that not only the healing, they go forward in Christ and they continue to spread the works of Jesus and say, he healed me. What do you want? What are you expecting him to do for you? Amen. Well, we received this answer to prayer. For years, this prayer request has actually been in the prayer tower. And as I read this, you may remember what it is. Well, the answer came back. First Lieutenant Clint Lawrence has been pardoned by President Trump. Jesus. We brought a letter and a photo to be put in the prayer tower about 2 years ago. He'd been wrongfully accused of war crimes and imprisoned. He's a young man, a patriot, and his mother was beside herself over this. After much prayer, he has been pardoned. Two or three other soldiers, also true patriots in the same situation, were pardoned, who were innocent but wrongfully imprisoned since 2013 approximately. Thank God. Thank you for praying. God is faithful and justice has prevailed. Hallelujah, Jesus. Can we just give a, how long sometimes do we wait for our answer to come? And when God finally shows up, do we just say, oh, thank you, Jesus? No, we say, thank you, Jesus. I'm glad I didn't give up. I'm glad I didn't stop believing. I'm glad that I held on to your hand, Jesus. You are a God of miracles, and we give you all the glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. God is faithful. A lady called for prayer because she lost her pocketbook and her keys. License and other important things were in it. Ever been there? She called for prayer, and just 10 minutes later, she called again saying, praise God, I found my pocketbook. Thank you for praying. Amen. A lady called for prayer because they were selling their condo and the buyer kept postponing the closing for petty reasons. The phone worker prayed with her and they felt that God was already moving on it right that moment. Well, she called back less than 2 hours later to say the closing went through. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. A man called for a prayer because his truck had been totaled and the insurance check wasn't going to be enough to get another. But after prayer, God turned things around in his favor. Not only was he going to get one, but he got two vehicles, one for him and one for his wife. Hallelujah. God is good. A man called for prayer one night because he was in crippling pain from a health problem. But after prayer, the pain subsided and it left. He called back the next day to give thanks and says, I'm not in pain right now and I should be. Thank you for praying. Amen. A couple weeks ago, a lady looked into the hidden compartment of her wallet where she liked to stash a few extra dollars and it was empty. When the peanut butter need came, she thought she should have gone to the bank. But digging to find some money, the thought came to her, look in the secret place. She thought, it's empty. But she looked anyway. There were three large bills there. She took one out and put it in the jar. Then this past Sunday morning, when the opportunity presented itself again, she went back to the hidden compartment and was able to double what she put in before. She says, God promised us our heart's desire, and he never fails. Amen. Hallelujah. A lady's blood sugar was very high and the doctor sent her to the ER. But after prayer, her blood sugar went down and she was released to go home. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. A lady's knee was in so much pain that she couldn't move to do anything. She got prayer at the altar and it got a little better. Well, then for the next few days, she just kept praising God for her healing and all the pain is gone. She is praising Dr. Jesus. Hallelujah. He met her need. A lady who previously had heart surgery is praising God because she had her yearly checkup and all is good. The doctor did not find another concern and sent her to a specialist, she has no damage, no blockage, and she is going to be fine. She said she held onto that scripture in Psalm 41:1. Blessed is he that considereth the poor. The Lord will deliver him in time of trouble because God has been faithful. Amen. Well, I want to end with these. It says, after prayer, a man doesn't need to have surgery again. He says it means a real lot to him and he's thankful. He cannot say enough about how good God is. And he tells everybody, thank you for praying. A lady had called for prayer because she had bought a secondhand car and was having problems with it. But after prayer, the dealer came to get it, is fixing it, gave her a loaner, and even though her husband signed the paperwork for as is when they purchased it, this dealer has integrity and God is good. He's looked out for his own. Thank you for praying. The scripture says, the righteous cry, the Lord heareth and delivereth them out of them all their troubles. God is a good, good father, and he's perfect in all his ways towards us. Amen.
Praise God. Let's just give the Lord another clap offering for all those great, great answers to prayer. And through your prayers, through your giving, that's what's happening. It's meeting people's needs. Amen. Amen. Well, our worship team is going to come and sing for us before Minister Ben Westry is going to come up and preach to us this morning. God bless you. Turn to your neighbor one more time while they're coming and just tell them something good that God did for you this week. Amen. Let's keep it current. Go ahead. Amen.
Christ the Savior of the world, He has come. Alleluia. Alleluia. To the highest name of all,
The Savior of the world has come. He's come. Why don't you just lift your hand and say, you're the highest name. You're the highest name of us. Repeat that. Come on, say that again. Do you believe that? High above everything. High above every sickness, every disease, every disappointment in life, every struggle you're going through, there's a name above that. Come on, do you believe it? Say it again. You're the highest name. Begin to worship. Take this moment to worship, not to just sing a song, but to proclaim a truth, a biblical truth, that his name is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, every tongue shall confess. Come on, one more time. You're the highest name. Come on, church, I want to hear you. Come on, church, I want to hear you. You're the highest name. Say it again. Bless your name this morning, Jesus. We bless your name today, Jesus. We thank you that we're in your house together, that we have the Word of God to open and to share together. God, we believe what this book says, that we are blessed because of you, Jesus. We're blessed not because of our human efforts alone, but we're blessed because we know you, God. We bless your name this evening, Lord, or this morning, Lord. We thank you. Christ's name, amen. You can be seated. I'd like you to take your Bibles out this morning. Hallelujah. Do you have your Bible? Turn with me to Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And while you're turning there, just remember that it's only a few more weeks, and it'll be a new year. It'll be a new year. What would you like to see this coming year? Who knows? God may answer your prayer before the 31st. Amen. But I have some things I'm believing God for this coming year as well. And I believe he's able to do it. Are you there? Can you say amen if you're there? All right, let's read together the scripture. It says, "Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee, and I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee." I want you to hear that word right there. I will bless thee. I'm going to say that again. I will bless thee. And make thy name great, say it. Make thy name great, say it with me. Make thy name great, and thou shalt, say with me, be a blessing. Say it one more time. Be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee. And I will curse them that curseth thee. And in thee and in you shall all families of the earth be blessed. I'm going to read that scripture to you one more time. I'm going to read it in Amplified. It says this, and I will bless, do good for, or benefit those who bless you. And I will curse, that is, subject to my wrath and judgment, the one who curses, despises, dishonors, or has contempt for you. And in you, all the families or nations of the earth will be blessed. This morning, I want to talk to you briefly about a mission-minded God. A mission-minded God. It is God's desire to be known and to bless the world. I mean, that is his heart. I believe we serve a God that is faithful. I believe we serve a God that is just and righteous. There are those that would contend this. They would contend the existence of God based on what they believe his character is. Well, I believe his character is good. I believe he's a good father. And his desire is to be known of his people. Now, I want to ask you a question. Do you remember when God pursued you? Do you remember when God pursued you? We like to believe that we have more to do with this than we really do. I mean, we have responsibility in the matter, don't get me wrong. But God really does a majority of the work, folks. It is his desire, it is his plan that you would know him. And now think of all the things God did to have you in this building today. Think of it. I want to know how many lived out of the state and God brought you here. Look around. Okay. I want to know who lived out of the country. Look around. Hey. And God brought you here. How many lived in town? God brought you here. It's amazing the stories that are woven together to make this wonderful place called the church. I would love to tell you that it's a building. And I find it funny that people look for churches based on, you know, location, proximity to their jobs. You know, we have a real, like, modern view of what the church is. But the church is where God calls you and the people he calls you together with, who he gathers you with to worship together. And that becomes his body. We are the body of Christ in this town. Now, we're a piece of the body. There's many other churches that are worshiping today, and they are the body of Christ also. But I want you to know God has placed you here among this group of believers, and he's brought some of you from many miles to this place. What a magnificent plan God had to bring you here. Some of you were born in the church. It's all you know is church. You got up every Sunday morning, whether you liked it or not, and you were in church. And every Sunday night, whether you wanted to or not, mama dragged you and your books and your blanket to church. It's all you know. Bible study is normal, right? And then you find out, oh, everybody don't go to Bible study, but I go every week. God orchestrated you, whether you liked it or not at times, to be a part of the church. And why would God go through all that trouble if he did not have a plan and purpose for your life? And why would God do everything that he did if he didn't plan on taking your life and doing something amazing with it? We serve a God who is strategic in his actions. He is perfect in all of his ways. He knows what he is doing. Despite the circumstances I may be in this morning, I have to put my foot upon this truth and stand in this fact that God put me here for a purpose. And I may not understand it today, but I know tomorrow God has it in his hands. And I can't control what happened yesterday, but today, in this moment, right now, I have to trust that God knows the plans that he has for me. Look at your neighbor, say, God has a plan. Look at your other neighbor, say, God has a plan. If they look a little sleepy, elbow them, say, hey, God has a plan. God has a plan. A little too busy this week. God has a plan. God is not interested in you being confused about who he is. That's foolish. God went above and beyond to introduce himself to you. You sit in this building today because God has introduced himself or is trying to introduce himself to you. I noticed something about me in particular. Sometimes I am thinking. My mind goes a lot of different places at once. If you know me, I can be talking to you about something, thinking about something completely different, and trying to do something in the middle of all that. That's just the way my mind works. A little ADD, I guess. I'm not the only one. There's a few of us folks out there. Don't be ashamed. But I noticed that I have a way of sometimes not ignoring folks, but people can be talking to me, and my wife has to elbow me and say, "Hey, so-and-so's talking to you." And I'm like, "Oh, I missed that." I've done that to people before, and I've had to apologize on a few occasions. Notice this, that there are times when God has been trying to get my attention, and I've been busy doing other things. And you're like, "Oh, you tried to tell me this a month before I got into the problem." Yeah, anybody figured out God was trying to spare you of that nonsense you got yourself into? Any honest saved people here? I mean, I was, if I would have just listened, I could have avoided weeks of digging out of this mess. If I would have just, God is, and I'm just so glad he's not offended easily. I'm sorry. God, if God was offended every time I ignored, I'd be long gone, folks. But he works with us, and he desires for us to know him. And he calls our name, and he speaks to us when we're not listening. And when we're just doing our own thing, and when we're shopping for the holidays and worried about the bills and angry because so-and-so called out of work during the busy season again, and they're the lazy one on the team, and they always got to call out sick right before the holidays, and you know they're going to call out the day after Thanksgiving. It should be a holiday. But they're not even going to be there. And you're frustrated and angry about what's happening in your life. And meanwhile, God is saying, "Hey, over here. Over here. I'm trying to let you know something. You're frustrated with life. And you're frustrated with this situation. But I was here the whole time trying to let you know that situation is in my hand. I have it under control. And you may not like the outcome, but I want you to know it's up to me. I'm in control of this. And if you just give your life over to me, I can take what's messed up and I can make it beautiful if you'll just put that situation in my hand." Have you ever walked through that time in your life? Holding on to what belongs to God. Have you ever tried to fix what is God's job to fix? Have you ever tried to out-talk Jesus in your life and say, "No, I got this one, God. I got this." And God is saying, "Okay, enjoy it. Enjoy the mess you'll find yourself in. But when you realize that I know the plans that I have for you, you can turn back to me, and I won't reject you. I won't cast you aside. We'll chalk this one up to a learning experience, and I will get you on the right path again." We serve a wonderful God that wants to make himself known to you. Wants to know you. That I might know him, Paul said. The power of his resurrection. And God, sometimes we have to go through the fellowship. We have to go through suffering with him. But it's in times of suffering and pain and things that just don't work out well or the way we desired them to work out. That's when we find out who God is in my life. And he's more than just an ATM machine that blesses you with cash. He's more than a bank you roll up to you. I got myself into a mess. Can I make a transaction, Lord? I believe God will bless you financially, but I know him deeper than that, folks. I know when I lay on my bed at night and I'm confused and I don't know what to do, he's there to give peace in my mind. And when I don't know which way to go, I found out he's a compass and he directs my path. And when my emotions and my anxieties and things are just acting up and I feel a pit in my stomach about tomorrow, the song comes to mind. I don't know about tomorrow. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know. And that same God that knows tomorrow is willing to take my hand and walk me through the valleys and through the mountains and through situations that I've gotten myself in. Ask your neighbor, have you messed up recently? And look at him and say, but I'm still here because I know who holds tomorrow. Hallelujah. He is not a God who wants to remain mysterious to you. I want to continue to just go down this path. I feel the Lord leading me down this path that there are those today who know church and you know religion and you know the right things to do, but do you know Jesus? He's more than a story that your parents told you. He's more than good morals. Hello? Church kids, he's more than good morals. He's a living, breathing God that will be with you and in you and walk with you and lead you and guide you, and he wants to be a friend. It's more than a story. I want to ask you, do you know him today? Do you know him? Well, Abraham, the main character of our text today, was no different than you. Talked about him a few months ago now. Abraham didn't grow up with the most righteous situation in his home. His home was a little messy. In fact, God said, you got to get out of there. Anybody relate with that one? Things were a little messy in my past. Anybody can? Things were messy back yesterday, things were a little messy for me. And God called Abraham and said, get you out of the place where you live. And let's just say, Abraham, you grew up in Section 8, south side of town. Train tracks dividing the good folks from Abraham's side of town. I want you to leave where you're at, and I want you to go. Where am I going? Just go. Abraham obeys the Lord, and the Bible says and teaches us, because he was willing to go and he obeyed God, that God blessed him. Now, I often ask this question, because I don't believe God loves one person over another. It's just not his character. It's not who he is. We have three boys, and I love them all. They're all different. They all challenge me in different ways. The newest one is challenging sleep, right? That's what he does. He challenges sleep. One of them's got a little attitude right now that we work with, and the other one, we can't find him when it's time to bring the groceries in the house. They all have their challenges, but I love them all, right? Love them all. My mom could write a book about my flaws. Like, we got flaws. We are flawed people. And I believe God loves us. I wonder, how many people did God call besides Abraham? Did God speak to anybody else? I just think there are some things that the Bible doesn't necessarily go into, but I just know who God is. And he called, I believe, to more than one person. I just believe that. But Abraham is the one who said, I'm going to obey. And because of that, he was blessed. Now, because he was willing to do what other people wouldn't do, God pronounced a blessing upon him. And he said, those that bless you will be blessed, and those that curse you will be cursed. In other words, how people treat you, it will come back on them. Wow. That's powerful. Powerful. Now, was it because God favored him? Now understand, I'm talking about something different. When I say favor, I'm not talking about the love of God, which is the same for humanity. I'm talking about there's favor upon his life. Abraham did something obedient, and it brought an extra blessing on his life. But why would God do this? Well, I believe God was introducing himself to the world through Abraham. God, a very specific God, our God, the God of heaven and earth, chose a very specific instrument to introduce him to the world at large. God is not exclusive to any person. It is God's desire to bring the whole world to him. And he was going to use Abraham to do that. And so Abraham became a blessing to everybody that would come with him. All right, so then let me just move through this. We find Abraham to be a blessing to the world. Is God cruel to people who don't know him? Is God cruel to other nations? I believe we're cruel to each other. It is God's desire to be known of every nation. It is his desire to be known. And I would ask a person who questions that if they have really read the Bible, or are they just frustrated with life? If you read the Bible carefully and understand God's purpose through history, you'll understand that God has woven mission, his desire for the world, throughout all Scripture, Old and New Testament. Salvation has never been exclusive, but rather inclusive, and redemption has always been his goal for humanity. This is not advocacy of universalism, which means there's salvation with no parameters to meet. No. What I'm saying, a specific God used a specific nation, a specific person to reach the entire world. And from time to time, even those chosen people made mistakes, yet God worked with them. So I want to read to you something in the book of Exodus. I'm going to read it amplified for you, and you can read it when you get home. But Exodus chapter 9, verse 13 through 16, it says something awesome. How many grew up with Moses being the center of the story for this? You were always taught that Moses was the center of this story. You can raise your hand if you're honest. Like, Moses is the center point, right? What if I told you God is the center of that story? You're like, well, of course. Well, then why don't we read this from the perspective of God and not our main character, Moses, who we love to talk about, and he should be. God called him. He had flaws, and he had his own issues, and he has an amazing story. But what if I told you God had an objective, too? God had the ultimate objective. All right, this is what it says. Then the Lord said to Moses, get up early in the morning, stand before Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, let my people go so that they may serve me. For this time, I will send all my plagues. Now, for those that aren't Bible scholars or haven't been in the church a long time, we find the children of the descendants of Abraham are in captivity, right? They have been held for some 400 years within the grips of a tyrant who had mistreated them, inflicted violence upon them. And the Bible says in the beginning of Exodus that God had heard the cries of his people, so he said he was going to send a deliverer. I want you to know something. Their story in Egypt was not always this way. Their story in Egypt actually started with Joseph becoming a blessing, another descendant of Abraham, giving great advice to the king or to Pharaoh, and they fed the entire world. And so we find a people that were once favored and had good things in their life now being mistreated. Life is that way sometimes.
What starts good sometimes can turn upside down. You started blessed, but you find yourself through no wrongdoing of yours. And that's what people would try to tell you. You messed up, so that's why you're here. Not always, folks. Sometimes life changes, and we don't like those changes, and we find ourselves in the midst of really hard struggles. Here are the people of Israel in a really bad situation. Let me keep reading. Verse 14, it says, "For this time I will send all my plagues on you in full force, and on your servants and on your people, so that you may know without any doubt and acknowledge that there is no one like me in all the earth. For by now I could have put my hand out and struck you and your people with a pestilence, and you would have then been cut off, obliterated from the earth. But indeed, for this very reason," who's talking here? What is God is giving Moses a message to give to Pharaoh. "But I have, indeed, for this reason, I have allowed you to live." Is God cruel, or does God want to reach out to people? Listen. "But indeed, for this reason, I have allowed you to live, in order to show you and your nation my power." Now, if we know anything about Egypt, they had 100 million, they had thousands and thousands of gods that they were serving. "For this reason, Moses, I want you to go speak to him that they might see which God has power." You'll see this, the same theme throughout the Old Testament, over and over and over again. God saying, "Let me show you who I am. Everything, everyone is below who I am. You don't have to serve God, a God that doesn't have ears and doesn't have eyes and can't see. You can serve the God that created everything." Amen. That's the kind of God he wants to introduce himself. For this very reason, I have allowed you to live in order to show you my power, in order that my name may be proclaimed throughout all the earth. It is God's desire today to introduce himself to the lowest of the low. God, in his conversation, spoke through Moses to the taskmaster. The Pharaoh, the ultimate power of the earth at that time, so they believed. God spoke with him, with the taskmaster, and said, "I want you to know me." God used Moses, and God will use you to people you find vile and people you look down upon. Hello, all right, can we go here? People you don't have the highest opinion of, God will use you to introduce himself to them. Isn't that amazing that God would take Moses, and we all know Moses' story is kind of, It's a crazy story, but God used Moses to speak to what many consider an evil man. God could have destroyed him instantly, could have destroyed all of Egypt, but progressively and over time, he gave them opportunity. The day before the hail fell and destroyed and killed their cattle, he said, "Tomorrow." In other words, "I'll give you 24 hours to get it right." Is God merciful? Is God loving? Is God interested in you knowing him? Even when Pharaoh had, through pride and arrogance, said, "No, I'm going to do what I want to do," God said, "I'll give you 24 hours. Think about it. I've already messed some things up. I can mess a lot more up, but I'll give you 24 hours. And I know there's got to be somebody here this morning that can say, "Thank God for the mercy. Thank God for the time he gave me. Thank God for the opportunities that he gave me over and over again. It could have been gone. I could have been done a long time ago. But through the grace and the mercy of God, I have one more chance to get it right. I got another chance to get it right. I got another chance to get it right. I can get up if I want to. I don't have to remain this way, in this condition. I'm telling you, I am more convinced every day that the greatest fault we have is pride. It keeps us from God. Even when God is trying, our pride says, I got it from here, Jesus. I'll take the wheel, Jesus. I got it. I'll drive the car. I know where I'm going. I got this figured out. And it keeps us from knowing the wonderful nature of our God, whose desire is to bless us and not have a curse upon our lives. Hallelujah. Isn't he good? Look at your neighbor. Say, God is good. And I'll let you be cliche this morning. Say, all the time. Say, all the time. God is good. God is good. Just remember this. The promise of Abraham was living within their own walls. And when Joseph was there, they prospered the whole world. But when they began to mistreat God's people, they began to suffer. The prophets continue this theme throughout the Old Testament. God wants to bless every nation, and he wants to do it through you. He's a mission-minded God. I just want to return to what I said in the beginning. He's a mission-minded God. He wants you to know him, and then he wants you to introduce him to the rest of the world. God wants to continue to propagate his love through the world. Isaiah chapter 19, 24 through 25 is an interesting scripture. I'm going to read this to you. You don't have to turn there. But it's something that I find very, very, very interesting, because there are certain what we call villains in the Bible, and two of those villains are Egypt and Assyria, the land of Assyria. They were opponents to God's people throughout. But God at one point speaks to the prophet Isaiah, and he says this, in verse 24 through 25, in that day shall Israel be the third with Egypt and with Assyria. In other words, all three of these nations will be together in agreement, even a blessing in the midst of the land, whom the Lord of hosts shall bless, saying, blessed be Egypt, my people, and Assyria, the work of my hands, and Israel, mine inheritance. Here we have what many would consider the villains of the Old Testament. But it was not God's desire. His desire was that nations would come into covenant or an agreement with him. And people want to know, what does it mean to be saved? What does it mean to know Jesus? It means that you're going to come into an agreement with God. I'm going to give up. Anytime there's an agreement, there's a give and there's a take, right? And when I bought my house, they took my money. But I took that house. I gave up something, but I got something. When I married my wife, we'd entered into an agreement together. She took my name. I gave her headaches too. Betty, I heard you, Betty, from way back there. But we give and take. There's an agreement, and God is no different. If you come to him, this is the great thing, though. He takes all the bad part of the deal, though, and that's us. Like, we're the trouble in the deal. I'll give you my joy, my peace. I will give you blessings, and you're going to give me what? Oh, my God. What did you bring to the table? What did you bring? Oh, I brought God plenty of headaches, plenty of struggles, plenty of stress, plenty of anxiety, plenty of this, plenty of that. He says, come, let us reason together. Whew. Oh, I love Jesus this morning. Come, let's have a conversation about your life. Though your sins be as scarlet, dark red, my blood will wash away every one of those. I gave my life to get give you life. Like he takes all the trauma, the trouble, the issues, and he gives us blessings. What amazing God we serve. What an amazing God we serve. What an amazing God we serve. This is more than religion. This is more than showing up in a building on Sundays. This is more than something you do out of obligation. This is something that I wake up in the morning on Monday. No preacher has to be there. No organ or piano player or drummer has to be there. The presence of God, wherever I lift my hands and magnify Jesus, wherever I just whisper his name and say, Jesus, thank you for breath. Thank you for life. Thank you for the food that I have. Thank you for the family I have. Thank you for the, Lord, at times I have to thank you for the trouble. Thank you I have an electric bill to pay. Thank you I have a house with high taxes. Thank you for all, thank you for every blessing that I have in my life. It's easy to complain when you're not thankful. It's easy to complain when you're not grateful, but can somebody here just take a moment and thank him for every blessing that he's given to you? Remind yourself of the goodness of God. Remind yourself. You could be anywhere in the world. You could be struggling to have clean water to drink. You could. But you're here now on the giving end. Together we worship. Together we praise. The church, the body of Christ. The head and not the tail. Above and not beneath. Bless when we come in. Bless when we go out. I think you can do a little better than that this morning. I really believe that we can open our mouths this morning and magnify the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the author of creation, the I am that I am. Hallelujah, the bright and morning star, the lily of the valley. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us praise the name of the Lord. You're the highest name that I know. You're the highest name above all. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'll finish up this morning with a couple of words for you. God introduces himself and desires to know the vilest of sinners. We used to sing a song back in the day. If you're over 35, I assume you remember this one. Yes, I know. Yes, I know. Jesus' blood can make the vilest sinner clean. Well, I'll say that again. I felt the Holy Ghost. Yes, I know. Yes, I know. Jesus' blood can make the vilest sinner clean. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, I know it. I know it. I've experienced it. His blood can make the vilest sinner clean. No one is left out. No one, despite their history of failures, would be excluded. Egypt had quite the history, a negative history. But yet God desires that they would know him. The prophet Jeremiah was tasked to speak in Jeremiah 1:5 to all nations. Zechariah the prophet speaks to Israel and Judah about his desire for them to be a blessing to all nations. God's desire is to be known. I would ask you today, if God is willing to introduce himself to the vilest of sinners, He says, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, though your sins have stained you, though your sins have ruined you, though you have... There were times when I grew up, I want to share this, in the neighborhood, certain people had reputations that would follow them. There would be people with reputations. So, reputation meant you were either tough, you could handle yourself in a fight, or you could be a punk and you would run from conflict. There were others that had the reputation of being too friendly with the guys. There were those that would have other things, but sometimes your past attempts to define your present and ultimately define your future. Come, let us reason together. Though your sins have stained you, though people see your sins are all over you, though people look at you and see what you've done to yourself, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, I will make them white. I will make it like it never happened. If that don't give you hope, there's not much that will. Application. Let's apply this to our daily lives. What feelings do you have of disqualification? Does it seem even relevant at this point? What can disqualify you from God loving you? I don't believe that there is anybody in the building outside of his reach. And that is awesome. You may feel that way. And people may have pronounced a reputation over you. But your feelings and their opinion is not biblical. It is not the word of God. And this is why when you come around me, I don't need you to point out all my issues. I'm well aware. I got some. What I need you to do is tell me, get back up again, brother. You'll get it right this time. This is what I need from you. This is what I need from you. Your feelings are not biblical. I just want to point that out to you today. I can't, God, because of this. Well, you take that up with God. He's telling you something different. I'm going to go with him. He says, though your sins be as scarlet, I will make them white as snow. God could redeem Egypt and Assyria, why wouldn't he redeem you? So let's apply this to our daily lives. Let's apply this to our daily lives. When you look at this story, we know this truth, that the people of the Hebrew slaves were in bondage for many years, and they were released by the mighty hand of God. But I want to speak to the church for just a second and let them know that this is not just a spiritual story, because we know that we equate this story frequently with salvation on the cross, and yes, it means that. But there's also a practical carrying out of this message. There are those, if you look at the story, you'll realize that Egypt held those Hebrew slaves not because those Hebrew slaves did anything wrong, but because life happened the way it happened. Rulers were in place that were unjust and greedy, and they used others to benefit their game and to build their name. We have an obligation as the church, the people of God, to not only preach the gospel, but to be kind to the people around us. It is not one or the other. There are those that preach what many call liberation theology, meaning that works and salvation is attained because of the charity work that we do. No, it's not that alone. It is understanding that Jesus himself died on the cross to bring us salvation. And we preach this gospel that God came to deliver the world. But we should also realize that if our brother is bleeding, we should pick them up, bandage them, and preach the gospel while doing it. This seems really simple, and it is. It is. But I think it's so easy for us to make the mistake of getting in our what I call the church bubble. And you have no interaction of significance with people that aren't saved. It's almost like you're afraid to touch people that aren't saved. But I want to challenge you this week to speak to somebody outside of your bubble. It's wonderful. We do ministries. We do all that stuff. And that's wonderful to be commended. And it's what we should do. But I want to know, is there somebody in your family that's coming over for the holidays that could use kindness from you? Is there somebody that you work with on that third shift who comes in and you can smell the alcohol on their breath? Is there somebody you can smell the weed coming from around the corner? Is there somebody that is vile? Maybe you should sing to yourself, yes, I know. Yes, I know. Jesus' blood can make the vilest sinner clean. I don't know what they're into, but I know this, that there are those around us every day that need the message of salvation, and they need your time. It's more than just stopping by and giving a quick word. That's easy. But if you asked them out for coffee, that would take you some time. And it would mean you'd put something aside to win somebody. To win somebody. Do what you're doing. Continue to do it. It's great. But could you, during this season, this time, in fact, in life in general, be purposeful in who you reach out to? There go I, but for the grace of God that somebody reached out to me. I have no problem standing up here and saying, the first time I got high, I came to a church service as a church kid. Should have been ashamed of myself. But hey, I just knew religion at that point. But Jesus saved me, so who am I to withhold the grace of God to somebody because they don't look right, they don't talk right, they don't smell right? Hello, somebody. Could you reach out? Why don't you reach your hand up this morning and say, God, I'm going to reach out to somebody this week. Because it's your desire. It's your desire this morning that we would reach out to the world and introduce them to your loving kindness. Why don't we praise God this morning and thank him today for his grace and for his mercy. Will you stand to your feet this morning as we continue to pray, if our musicians and ushers would come? Hallelujah. And if you could move as quietly as possible while we ask, is there anybody here that is away from the Lord, to come and reason with him, come talk with him? Now is the time to step forward and come pray with somebody. I'm going to give it a minute. Hallelujah, church. Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's pray. God, I'm far from you. I know it. God, I'm far from you. I know it. God, I'm far from you, and I know it. There's no shame in admitting when you're wrong. Come, let us reason together. Is there anybody else? Come, let us reason together. The invitation is there. Let's talk about it. I'm going to ask somebody else that you're a church person, what people would call you. But you're dealing with some of your own issues, some things going on in your heart, and you haven't been able to trust God with it yet. Would you give it to the Lord this morning? I know you're saved. Don't mean you're not saved. I know you're filled with the Holy Ghost. I know. But there's something in your life that you haven't trusted God with yet. Would you step out now? Say, God, I need to trust you with this. I don't care what it is. I need to trust you, God. If you need God to touch an area of your life, maybe you're new here and you want somebody to pray with you, step forward. There's folks standing here with Bibles in their hands. They're going to pray with you. Don't be shy. Don't be ashamed. Come find a place to pray. We're not staring at you. You feel that way, but we're not. Step forward. Come on. Don't be ashamed. God, I need to trust you with this area of my life, and I'm going to do it. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, continue to step forward. There's room up front here. Pull in if you want to pray. Step forward. There's people trying to get to the altar. Step forward. Make your way to the altar if you need to find a place to pray. There's room over here. There's room over there. Let's get together and pray together. Hallelujah. One of the best things about being in church is that we share each other's burdens and we lift them up and give them to the Lord together. We get to carry these struggles together. We don't do it alone, but there's somebody standing next to you that is going to pray for you, right? Somebody's going to pray with you. So today, we're going to pray with each other. I want you to put your hand on somebody next to you and just begin to pronounce the blessings of God on their life. What does that mean? That means to let them know that God is with you. God is for you and not against you. You can trust God with your struggles, and you don't have to wander alone through this world. I'm with you. I'm here to lift you up. I'm here to pray with you. I'm here to encourage you. You can do it. You can make it. Hallelujah. You're not going through this alone. Together. Together we fight. Together we win. Together. If you struggle, we'll go through it together. Together we'll go through this. Together we win. Together we have the victory. Together. We fight together. We pray together. We worship together. We win together. We're the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we won't fail. We won't falter. We win because of the blood of Jesus.
It's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are.
Hallelujah. How many this morning made a decision? How many? Let me see your hands. How many made a decision to obey the word of God that you heard this morning and change the situation? Come on now. Because that's what it's going to take in the day we live in. When you hear the word and it challenges a part of your life, then you come. And I'm glad that we pray for one another. That's good, and I appreciate that. I really do. But when it comes to certain things, only your decision can change it. Amen? So this morning, let's put our hands up, and let's go by our own personal decision this morning. Let's tell God what we're going to do. How we're going to change it. How we're going to line up our lives with His Word. How we're going to take His offer of let's reason together. You know, every covenant has an agreement on both sides. God's, I believe everything Ben preached is true. God's always giving good things, but we're not always accepting it. When are we going to learn to say enough? I'm not fighting you anymore. I'm not going to do my own thing anymore. I'm going to trust you, God, 100% with my life. And guess what's going to happen? You're going to have to change some things. Come on, somebody. How many has made changes in your life since you've been saved? Come on, wave your hand. Yeah, it's up to us. But if we will do it, there is nothing good that God will withhold from you. Amen? He upholds nothing good from those who walk uprightly before Him. Amen? So now, I want you to lay your hand on your neighbor and say this. Neighbor, you can do it.
Neighbor, you can do it.
Hallelujah. Praise God. You can do it. Amen. Amen. Oh, let's thank God for His word this morning. Thank God for your blessings the rest of the day. Amen. Come back tonight looking for God to move in someone's life. God bless you. Get your loved one to another today. Amen.